Okay, Matthew chapter 5, verse 21 to verse 47. Jesus, in those verses, he sets out some particulars of the higher righteousness to which disciples are called, this righteousness that exceeds that of the scribes and Pharisees. And in chapter 5, verse 48, this greater righteousness is then summed up in this all-embracing demand. You therefore must be perfect as your heavenly Father is perfect. That being the goal, the perfection of Jesus, the one into whose image we're being transformed. And that's the target. And in Matthew chapter 6, Jesus cautions us to keep our motives pure as we pursue the kingdom living that he prescribes. So here he's calling disciples to this radical living, this living as kingdom participants. And then he warns us in chapter 6 that as we pursue this righteousness, that we have to watch our motives, because it's very easy to lapse into doing what you do for the praise of people. And in chapter 6, verse 1, he gives the controlling principle that the motive for righteous living cannot be to obtain the praise of men. Now, you may receive the praise of men because you're living for Christ, but that can't be your motivation. You can't live that way so that people will praise you and think you're wonderful, because in that you're serving yourself and not serving God. Well, Jesus gives that controlling principle, and then he applies that principle to the three pillars of Jewish piety, to almsgiving, prayer, and fasting. And he does that as examples of how that principle is to operate with regard to all religious activity. So here it is. That's how it's to be applied to all religious activity. Then after applying that principle to prayer, he goes almsgiving, and he applies it in chapter 6, verse 5 and 6. The principle from 6:1, he applies it to prayer. He then elaborates on kingdom prayer in chapter 6, verses 7 to 15. And if you remember last week, I skipped that and went down to his application of the principle to fasting in 16 to 18, because the three are right there. You have almsgiving, prayer, and fasting. And then when he's on prayer, he has what's essentially a digression on kingdom prayer. We went through down to 16, 18, and then we went back to chapter 6, verse 7, and started looking at this elaboration on kingdom prayer. And we saw in chapter 6, verses 7 and 8, that Jesus warns against babbling like in prayer like pagans do. This idea of this, you know, just repeating these phrases. God's not an impersonal force. He's not an impersonal force that can be mechanically manipulated into action by repetition or the right phrases or the right combinations of words, as though you're playing some kind of machine. And if I just get things right, you see, you know, I do these things right, and then I get the goody. He's not that way. See, that is not the way God is. The key to being heard by God is not the form or the number of one's words, but having a father-son, a father-daughter relationship. Well, that's the key to being heard by God. Now, when we ended, I was explaining that though prayer can change what God does, it does so only when the prayer is consistent with God's will, with the outworking of his larger plan. Now, we often don't know if that's the case. I don't know about you, but that's certainly true in my life. You're praying for some things, and we often do not know if what we're praying is consistent with what God is doing. And that is because we are finite, limited beings. We do not know all of the angles and aspects of God's working. And we do not know all of the ramifications. We're not omniscient. We can't see it all. So there are times we're asking for things, and we think, well, you know, this looks really good to me. As I said, Paul's prayer, remove this thorn. Three times he prayed. And I'm sure Paul's saying, look, this thing's hanging me up. I could go further, do more. This would be a good thing. He said, look, you know, you don't have to trust me. My grace is sufficient for you. So this winds up, and I think this causes difficulties with people. Right when we ended, I read a poem illustrating how God often responds to prayers in ways beyond and outside our comprehension. Now, by saying, when we pray and we say, at least whether we believe this and feel this, whether we articulate it or not, But when we pray and say, if it is your will, see, we're simply saying that we acknowledge God's supremacy and the inscrutability of his working, and that we accept his answer in the matter. That's what we're saying. I mean, God's plan is inscrutable, right? I mean, what he's doing. Paul says in Romans 11, 33 to 36, or 33 to 34, in those verses, how unsearchable are his judgments, how inscrutable his ways. For who has known the mind of the Lord or been his counselor? So you see, we understand that there is some ambiguity, things we don't understand and see. Why? Because God is God. So when we're saying this, if it is your will, it's simply an acknowledgement of his supremacy and of the inscrutability of his working and our acceptance of his answer in the matter. Those prayers are not faithless or prayers of doubt. Sometimes people say, we say, if it's your will, if you think that, well, that's faithless. No, it's not. See, those prayers aren't faithless. I mean, that would be a very serious thing, right? Because faith is a requirement for effective prayer. You see in Matthew 21, 22, James chapter 1, verse 6. See, those prayers are prayers of faith because we have every confidence in God, every confidence in his wisdom, in his love, in his power. We have all that confidence. See, we just realize our own place and our limitations. Example I've seen is like if a child asks his father to go get some ice cream, but says, but only if you think it's right. You see, if a child says that to his father, it in no way reflects poorly on the father or indicates a lack of trust in the father. It's just an acknowledgement that the father knows best and says, only if you think it's right. I want this, but I understand that you're God and I'm not. Now, it's an insult for a Christian to approach God with insecurity about being heard as the pagans approach their gods. That's what all this mechanical stuff is about, that God has to be induced or browbeaten into paying attention or caring. And it is an insult for a Christian to approach God with that kind of insecurity. That sense of alienation is the work of the enemy. When you feel that sense of alienation as a Christian, that you somehow can't talk to God and connect with God, and he's distant, and he's not looking forward or smiling, see, that's the work of the enemy. Because that's not how it is with Christians. The Spirit says in Hebrews 4:16 that Christians, those who come to God through the high priestly work of Jesus, that they are to approach the throne of grace with confidence. You see that same idea in Hebrews 10:19-22. We come in with confidence. Why? Because of Christ's work. We know that he hears us. We know that he is favorably disposed to us. We don't have to induce him to pay attention to us. We don't have to manipulate him. And so that's all wrapped up in this. And then Jesus says, after he says that in 6:9-13, he says, pray then like this. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. I put the brackets there because that's a footnote in the ESV. Many other translations go with the evil one, and I think that's the right sense. So deliver us from the evil one. See, in contrast to this mechanical, repetitive, manipulative prayers of pagans, Jesus in these verses, 9 through 13, he provides an example of how to pray. It's not a script. It's not a prescription of what to pray, but a model of the kind of attitudes and concerns that should guide the prayers of disciples. You see, so that's what it is. It's a model of the kinds of attitudes and concerns that should guide our prayers. And he begins, he says, our Father in heaven. And the description of God as Father, that communicates an awful lot. You see, he borrows from what we're very familiar with. And so he uses that and says, our Father. That says a lot about him. Among other things, it says that God is personal. He's not some force, some power, you see, that's just blind and mechanical. He is a being, and he is personal, and it says that he is caring. Craig Keener, in his commentary on Matthew, he says, this is a relationship, Father, that denotes both respectful dependence and affectionate intimacy, as well as obedience. All of that is tied up in the notion of Father. We may have lost some of that sense now in the way fathers are, but when you're thinking of a first century father, this idea of dependence is complete, respectful dependence, and affectionate intimacy. You see, there's no conflict between respect and intimate affection. It's not like we have to then downgrade the parent to have intimate affection with them, but we still maintain respect, you see. That's how it is with God, as well as obedience. Children in the ancient world were obedient. You see, they weren't viewed by the whole culture as that the world was made for them. And so this is all wrapped up in this concept. Right? He says, this is a relationship that denotes both respectful dependence and affectionate intimacy, as well as obedience. One must understand that God's fatherhood, one must understand what God's fatherhood would have meant to most of Jesus' hearers. In first century Jewish Palestine, children were powerless social dependents. And you can't imagine how much so. Dependent on their parents, dependent on their father. Okay, and fathers were viewed as strong providers and examples on whom their children could depend, in contrast to many homes in contemporary Western society. And that's true. We have many fathers who have simply, abdicated their responsibility as being fathers. Shameful to be a father and to not act like a father. You see, being a father is not simply breeding. Being a father is loving and nurturing and training and teaching and leading. You see? And so all of this is wrapped up in this image of father here where he sees this. Jesus summons his disciples to pray not like the pagans, but with a dependence on God as their father who watches over them. And so this is a powerful image to refer to God as father, and I think it's even more powerful in a first century context. And he says, our father. You see, in the fact he refers to our father rather than my father, it shows that Jesus is envisioning corporate prayer. He's envisioning corporate prayer, prayer that's uttered by or on behalf of the community. So that thing about when he says, go into your closet, and I was telling you that what he's after there, he's saying, you cannot pray, as you cannot do any other religious activity, for the sake or the purpose of drawing attention to yourself so people will think you're great. That's what he's after. I said he's not ruling out public prayer. You know that because Jesus prayed where he was heard. You see the church praying in the first century publicly. And you see it here where he says, our Father, he's contemplating corporate prayer. So this is what he talks about this. It speaks of a special relationship. So you see this, our Father, you see it speaks of corporate prayer, but it also speaks of a special relationship. God is our Father, the Father of disciples in a way that is distinct from his being the Father of all people. Is God in some sense the Father of all people? Yes, he is. He's the creator of everything. But is there a special sense? He is our Father as disciples of the Lord Jesus in a special... Yes, he is. You see, in John chapter 1, verse 12 and 13, but all who did receive him, did receive Jesus, who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. So there's another sense, right? Yes, there's a sense of you're all children of God and that God is the creator of all things. So as the source of all, yes, he's Father in that sense. But there is another sense. And it's that sense when he says, our Father. He is our Father in that distinctive sense of those who have been reconciled to him through Jesus Christ. And in fact, the early church forbade non-Christians from reciting this prayer for that reason. Because this is a reference. But he goes on, he says, to become children of God who are born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. So there, and that's this whole idea of we're born again, right? Born what? Born of God. Right? So that's an idea, that's included in there. And then the phrase in heaven, our Father, you have this about Father, our in heaven reminds us of his transcendence and his sovereignty. See, though our relationship with God, it truly is one of love and intimacy. It really is a relationship of love and intimacy. You see, it's also a relationship of reverence. God is too majestic to be our cosmic buddy. You see? You say, well, no. If you say that, then you're distancing. No, I'm not. Any more than you would distance a child from his parent. You've seen people who let their child treat them like they're not a father, but a buddy. Okay, and that's a crossing of a line of respect. You can have respect and honor and intimacy. I don't want to be my kid's father. I want to be his buddy. Well, then you need to be you need to have somebody talk to you. You see, because your role is father or mother. You see, and so this is a thing when I see it. And sometimes it's these are subjective things about when do we cross that line. But you get the idea, right? There are lines of just being too familiar with God in the sense of you're not respectful of God. We always have to be respectful. He is in heaven. He is transcendent. He is sovereign. He is glorious. And we must maintain that and hold on to that. Then he says, hallowed be your name. God's name represents God himself. It is an expression or an encapsulation of his identity and his nature. And the prayer is that God bring about the sanctification of his name, the honoring and the revering of himself as holy. It's a prayer. Hallowed be your name. Dear God, bring about the setting apart of your name. Bring about the glorification of your name, the honoring and revering of you as holy. Though he is disrespected and treated as nothing special in the world, right? That is the definition of he's profaned. That's the definition. He's profaned. He's what? He's not. He's treated as common. He's treated as ordinary. He's not exalted and lifted up and glorified. And so this prayer is that his name be hallowed, that God bring about the glorification of his name, that he bring about the rightful acknowledgement of him as holy and glorious by all, that he be honored and glorified as is fitting his greatness and his splendor. Hallowed be your name. Bring this about, that instead of being looked at by so many people as just nothing, you bring about your name that all glorify and revere who you are. Now, you see the motivation there? What is the drive of that? I want your name glorified in this world. And I think that's something important. It's quite a contrast to how we pray. I mean, you can't help but go through this and see the contrast. We are so heavy on petition for blessings and for meeting our needs and those of others, and so light on a desire for God to be revered in this world. And here he's giving us this model. Now, God certainly is exalted to some degree in the spread of the gospel. He is glorified in that. He is exalted and glorified to some degree as you and I live Christ-like lives. But the ultimate sanctification of his name, the ultimate setting apart of his name as holy and glorious, that will be when Christ returns to consummate the kingdom he inaugurated with his first coming. See, this is the final assertion of God's kingly rule, in which everything's brought into harmony with his will, and all sin and all the products of sin and all the corruption of sin and the stain of sin is eliminated. It's the eternal state, the goal of God's creation. And the next two requests, they reinforce, you see, that that's really the focus here. When he says, hallowed be your name, yes, his name is glorified and hallowed as the gospel is spread and people come to Christ. Yes, it is glorified and hallowed as we live Christ-like lives. But the real focus is on the glorification of His that will be there at the consummation. When Christ returns, you see that He says, "Your kingdom come. Your kingdom come." You see, this is how God is to sanctify His name, to show forth His ultimate glory. He is to consummate the kingdom that Christ inaugurated with His first coming. And it's this expectation that was behind the early church's Aramaic prayer, Maranatha, that you see in 1 Corinthians 16:22. "Come, Lord." What are they praying for? They're praying for the kingdom to come, to be consummated. You see, they're, "Come, Lord, come." This veil of tears that we continue to limp along in this overlap of ages, will you please come? And it's the same thing that we see, Revelation 22. Same idea is expressed there. It's expressed in Greek, Revelation 22:20, the next to the last verse of the book and the next to the last verse of the entire Bible. "Come, Lord Jesus." You see, this is the thing. What's the church praying for? The church is praying for the Lord's return and the consummation of the kingdom. And as disciples of Christ, we recognize that God's kingdom already has invaded this reality through the work of the Lord Jesus. And again, you see, why did I spend that time at the beginning? Because I told you, see, my approach to this is inaugurated eschatology. And I'm not alone in that. But I think it's so important. But we understand that the kingdom was inaugurated with Christ's coming, that the kingdom is a present reality, and we who have embraced and entered into that work through faith in Christ, we are the church, but we long for that day, right? We long for that day when the kingdom will be consummated, when heaven and earth will merge, so to speak. I like the phrase, when this creation will be heavenized. When they will merge and God's sovereignty will be fully and finally asserted. Here's what Charles Quarles says in his study of the Sermon on the Mount. Jesus' followers pray fervently and frequently for the coming of Christ's kingdom for good reason. The consummation of the kingdom will bring about the complete fulfillment of the great blessings promised in the Beatitudes. Do you remember as we went through the Beatitudes, those kingdom norms, and then you had these blessings? And on those blessings you saw, yes, there's an element of which we receive now, but there's still a future aspect to them that we will receive in spades at the consummation. So we went through, this is what he's talking about. Although Jesus' disciples now enjoy a partial fulfillment of each of these promises, they will experience the complete and final fulfillment of these promises only at Jesus' return. See, this is to be such a part of our lives that Paul describes Christians in 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 8, as those who have loved His appearing, meaning those who have set their affection on, the way the New English Translation takes it, or those who have longed for Christ's return. Longed for, that's the way it is in the New Revised Standard, the New Jerusalem Bible, the New International Version. He describes Christians as those who have longed for His appearing, His coming, His return, the consummation. That's what Jesus is saying, "Thy kingdom come." This is what, and so Paul describes Christians that way. Indeed, the point of the parable of the unjust judge in Luke chapter 18, verses 1 to 8, which is often misunderstood, is that disciples, as they long for the consummation without seeing it, as they long for it without seeing it, that they must never lose the heart to keep praying. They must never lose their expectation that God will indeed answer their pleas for vindication. Answer their pleas and He will vindicate them at the return of Jesus. And yet we seem to think and to speak and to pray so little about Christ's return. It's like we've bought into the idea, well, it's just been too long, let's forget about it. You can't. This is Christian theology. You can't just say, well, Nobody wants to talk about that. I mean, it's been going on. We don't know when. And so why even think about it? Because it is what things are driving for. We need to think about it. We need to pray about it. We need to talk about it. He says, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And see, this is an explanatory description of the request for God's kingdom to come at Christ's return. See, when the kingdom that he inaugurated is consummated, creation will be heavenized, as I say, that picture that's painted in Revelation chapter 21, one of the greatest chapters. Here's this whole, you have this creation that's made, it's good, it's very good. Sin invades, there's all of this, there's the flood, what are we going to do? Call out Abraham, create a nation, what are you doing? I'm redeeming this creation that sin is corrupted, and that's where it's headed. You see, that's where it's going. And we will share in that. See, we will all be party to that as Christians. But here you get this picture in Revelation 21. Everything's going to be brought into complete harmony with God's ultimate will and purpose. The new heaven and the heavens and the new earth. That's going to be, see, the divine utopia. A reality he describes there in which there'll be no more death, no mourning, no crying, and no pain. You won't open up the internet or go to one of your news sites and find people killing people and people torturing people and all of these other things that have to make us say, come, Lord Jesus. Aren't you tired? Don't you long for the reality where we will be, where God is fully and completely asserting his sovereignty and dominion so that there is no more death or crying or mourning or pain? How can we not? And that's why I say, this is what Christianity is about. And here we are talking about so many strange things in our culture. Things that just have absolutely no significance compared to this. But that's what's going on. And he says this, you know, that we need to do this. Now, hell, you know, when I was talking about this, Steve mentioned it one time. So, well, there's still going to be punishment. Yes, I'm not a universalist. You know, hell is going to be there. But hell is something that's going to be isolated or cut off from this existence so it's not even considered. Okay? Here we have the new heavens and new earth. And those who are of faith will share in that. And I used to say, and I've said here many times, on that day, you see, we will hug one another in redeemed resurrection bodies. And we're going to hug one another and celebrate. And we will talk about, do you remember when we sat there? Do you remember when we sat there and listened to you drone on? And we'll be there, you see, and it'll be like the joy that will never be taken. And it will be pure love, no questioning about people's motives. Are they trying to get? It'll just be family love completely in the very presence of God. It is a picture like nothing else. And that's what Jesus is talking about. Michael Wilkins, let me give you a couple of New Testament scholars here. Michael Wilkins says, the complete experience of God's will on earth will occur only when his kingdom comes to earth in its final form, causing an overthrow of all evil rule, Revelation 20, 1 to 10, and completing the regeneration of this earth, the heavenization. That's what Paul describes in Romans 8, 18 to 25. Robert Gulick, in his study of the Sermon on the Mount, he says, therefore, to pray, let your will be done, does point to the future when Satan and the forces of disobedience will be totally destroyed and the wicked and enemies judged and God rules supreme on earth as in heaven. See, that's the idea, you see, that he will be so fully asserting then. And that's, again, why I went through all that stuff before at the beginning of the class when I'm sure some of you were going, how does this relate to the sermon? And this is, I'm letting you see how I think it relates to the sermon. And I think that's something that's very important. He says, give us this day our daily bread. You see, now the prayer turns, this model turns from a primary emphasis on the future consummation of that day. You see, he's praying, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day. You see, give us here and now in this overlap of ages where we still struggle. We are weak, we are dependent, we need. Give us in this time, give us this day, our daily bread. We live in this overlap of ages. You see, this overlap of ages that I've diagrammed and talked about. Life between the Lord's coming and His coming again. And this is a prayer for basic physical needs. This is a prayer that God will meet our basic physical needs. It is one that recognizes and reflects total dependence on God. It recognizes and reflects that. Whatever the means of provision, however God works providing it for you, all good things come from God, right? I seem to recall James saying that. All good things come from God. And disciples have to remember and acknowledge that. I know you work for salary. And I know some of you work hard. But who gave you the ability to do that? You see, everything. You remember when the Israel's were going to come into the land, God warns me. He says, look, what's going to happen? He says, I'm telling you. You can get in there, you're going to be rolling high. Everything's going to be going good. And you're going to think, my hand got this. I earned this. I did this. And you always have to understand that everything that you have is a gift to you from God. And that's what this is, you see. So it is an acknowledgement and a prayer. I need in this overlap. I am dependent. I have to have these things. And I recognize that you are the source. And we as disciples, in dependent, humble prayer, say, give us this day our daily bread. And then he says, and forgive us our debts. Now this is a prayer for the forgiveness of sins, which are conceived as moral obligations owed to God that we didn't pay. You see, that's how you get to this debt idea. God says, I'm owed obedience. I'm owed moral living. And when you don't do it, well, you're in debt to me because you owed me this living and you didn't do it. So forgive us our debts simply means forgive us our sins. And that is, in fact, how Luke, in his version, in Luke chapter 11, verse 4, he simply says sins. Now, this is a recognition, you see, that we continue to sin on our journey to complete sanctification. In this overlap of ages, you and I, we are kingdom participants. We are born anew. We are regenerated, new-hearted people, those for whom the Beatitudes are kingdom norms. But you and I know we sin, right? I mean, that's not a secret, is it? So we sin, but we know that. As we go along in this overlap of ages, being sanctified, being transformed by the Spirit's power into the image of Jesus, that sanctification will not be complete until He returns. And so in this day, in this overlap of ages, we must pray for forgiveness because we are sinful people. We sin and it takes a modicum of introspection, you see, to say, yeah, ooh. When I start looking at the kinds of things the Lord talks about here, the depth where He comes and exposes really who you are. I say, okay, there are sins to be confessed, to be acknowledged and brought to God. You see, so this is what He's talking about there. And then He says, as we also have forgiven our debtors. Ooh, as we also have forgiven our debtors. And forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. As indicated in chapter 6, verses 14 and 15, we cannot sincerely or properly seek forgiveness while refusing to give it. I mean, how would you think that? That you're going to come to God, seek His forgiveness, your brother, sister, somebody else comes to you seeking yours, and you're going to say, give me forgiveness. No, you can't do that. John Stott comments, he says, once our eyes have been opened to the enormity of our offense against God, and I think that's part of the problem. You see, I think that's part of the problem. We don't really recognize, and that's because you and I are in a sea of sinners. You see, we're in a sea of sinners. And so we really kind of get accustomed to it and don't think it's really not that bad. That's part of the problem we have with hell, by the way. We cannot understand how God could justify condemning somebody eternally. And you say, well, sin, you don't understand the horror that sin is. Why? Because you're just floating in it with everybody else. You see, but he says here, once your eyes have been opened to see the enormity of our offense against God, the injuries which others have done to us appear by comparison extremely trifling. If, on the other hand, we have an exaggerated view of the offense of others, it proves that we have minimized our own. That's how we do this, because listen, you want to know what's really important? My sin against God, yeah, that's okay. I shouldn't have done that. Sorry about that. But you on me? Now that's serious. You see, that's really serious. This thing with God, look, he's in the forgiving business. Okay, so it's just really, you know, we'll take care of this. But you on me, that's tough. That's the dynamic that's at work. We don't put it out that way. But that's really the underlying dynamic of what's going on. Now this point is driven home, of course, powerfully in Jesus' parable of the unforgiving servant in Matthew 18, 23 to 35. As he shows in that story, I mean, it is an outrage. It is an outrage for a Christian who has been forgiven a breathtakingly large sin debt to God. It's an outrage for that Christian then to turn around and to refuse to forgive the relatively minuscule sin debt of a fellow Christian who seeks forgiveness. It's an outrage, and you see it in the parable where the people, as soon as they see it, they're just going, man, I can't believe he did that. I can't believe he did that, you see. Such a refusal to forgive, see, it establishes that the person is not a disciple. I'm sorry. It establishes that the person is not a disciple. The person is not somebody who has surrendered to the Lord Jesus. That person will be condemned. He or she will receive what his unforgiven sin deserves, his or her. You see, because if you will not forgive, you will not be forgiven. Why? It is because if you refuse something so basic as forgiving, then you don't know anything about Jesus. You don't know anything about him. You've got somebody coming to you asking for your forgiveness, and you say, drop dead, buzz off. You hurt me too much. I'm not going to do that. Well, what do you think you know? Do you think that you've been regenerated, that you've had a changed heart? Do you think that the Lord has come in and touched you, that the Spirit of God lives in you? And he says, no, that's not the case. And then he says, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. This is not a prayer for God not to tempt us, not to entice us to evil. That would make no sense, right? Since God does not tempt anyone. That's what tempt is. The word can be translated test and tempt. Same word. But when you talk about tempt, when you use that nuance to the word, it carries the sense of enticing to evil and to do wrong. That's the way we use tempt. Somebody's trying to get me to do something I shouldn't do. God never does that. Why would you think God would do that? We don't have to rely on that. We know for a fact James 1, 13 and 14 makes clear that he doesn't tempt anyone. Rather, you see, this is a prayer for God not to lead us into a situation. Not to lead us into a situation in which we are tempted successfully by Satan. A trial in which we are lured away because of our weakness from the avenue of escape that God has provided. Temptation here, it includes the sense of succumbing to the temptation. Don't lead us into a wilderness position where we will be overwhelmed and succumb to the temptation. From whom? From Satan. Don't do that. And you see this same sense, the idea that it includes succumbing, you can see that in 1 Thessalonians 3:5. For this reason, Paul writes, I myself, being no longer able to bear it, sent to learn about your faith, fearing that somehow the tempter had tempted you and that our labor had been in vain. Well, how do you know? Maybe he tempted me and I resisted. No, you see, he means tempted by he tempted you successfully. You see, I fear that he had bagged you. And that's the sense here. You see that it's a prayer, that the prayer is a humble recognition that though our spirit is willing, our flesh is weak, as Jesus said in Matthew 26, 41, and that we are vulnerable to temptation. It's simply a humble acknowledgement of that fact. We are not yet sufficiently like the Lord, sufficiently sanctified to withstand all that Satan can throw at us, as the Lord did when he was led by the Spirit. Lead us not into temptation. He was led by the Spirit into the wilderness. So what did he do? Perfect Son of God batted 1,000. Sent him out. You and I aren't there yet. You see? Now sometimes we think in delusions of grandeur, we think we are. I go toe-to-toe with him. I see these people on television. I'll go up there and I'll rock him in the eyeball. You see? But this is this idea of this humble recognition of what God, that we need God's deliverance. We must pray to be delivered or rescued from Satan by God's power rather than be brought into a place of overcoming temptation. That's what I think he's saying. It's a confession of our weakness, an acknowledgement of our absolute dependence on God for spiritual protection. See, we must never forget that our enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. Now we think, see, sometimes in our Western world and all this, we tend to think, well, you know, there was a guy, a theologian, who was famous for this concept of demythologizing the New Testament. Okay, and we've kind of fallen into that sometimes. Satan and all that stuff, I don't think about it. Look, there is a spiritual war going on. And the enemy you are fighting is clever and powerful, and you better fight him on your knees. You see, you better fight him on your knees. Because this is prayer for protection. Now, why is there so little acknowledgement of this in our prayers? Of seeking God's protection from the enemies that seek to do us harm. Spiritual enemies, powerful enemies. And that's what he's talking about. And so this is this model that he gives. And then in 6:14 and 15, he says, "For if you forgive others their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others their trespasses, if you do not forgive others their trespasses," let that soak in. Okay, it's pretty, English is my mother tongue. This is pretty clear. "Neither will your Father forgive your trespasses." You see how serious that is? Do you see how fundamental that is as a litmus test of a person's discipleship? You know, being a Christian isn't simply saying, "I think certain abstract facts are true." It is yielding to those facts. It is giving the Lord your life. Now, the one who died for you and redeemed you at such a tremendous cost, he says, "Come," and he says, "I call you as my disciple to be a person who forgives freely." And you tell him, "I'm not going to do it. I steadfastly, absolutely, despite this person coming to me asking for my forgiveness, refuse to do it." Well, do you see that it says, well, then you don't really understand. You've never really given me your heart. You've never really surrendered to me. And that is part of biblical faith. It is not simply abstract thinking. I believe these things are true. It is yielding to those. I am becoming yours. You say, "Lord, you've bought me. I'm owned by you. So if that's your call on my life, give me the power to do it, Lord." Okay? And this is serious, important stuff. I heard that second bell. Thank you for coming.